Welcome back to exercise 11 of complex wire removal with Silhouette and Mocha Pro. With the hair roto done on one side, we're going to turn our focus to the other side of the shot. And here we have hundreds of potential strands to deal with. Instead of rotoing all of those, we're going to do something new involving hair paint. And exercise 11 is all about how we prep to avoid as much work as possible. So let's crack on with it back in Silhouette. And welcome back. I've taken our project a little bit further now, but just extended out those same techniques that we were working on in the previous section. So I've come in, I've added a few more strands of hair over on the left-hand side. So that's looking kind of nice. Let's have a little look at the roto over there. Just a few more hair strands. Like the only thing that was really worth mentioning is I've used some open splines here. We just have a little look. So these particular shapes, let's go into my hair. There we go. Yeah, these particular strands are open spline shapes, and I've just put a stroke width on there. When you've got hair that's pretty much the same width all the way through, or just small strands, then it's much easier to do everything with open splines rather than closed splines. So those are the ones that look like this here, with a middle spline and then a border pushing those out. So yeah, so that's the only real thing that I did differently at that point, rather than just fill in the gaps. If we check out the alpha output, this is what we end up with here. There we go. You can see a bit of softness on the individual object, and on the hair itself, I've also turned on, let's open this up here, I've also turned on motion blur on the hair and turned on motion blur in the node. It just made sense just to do a bit of motion blur on the fast moving strands there. That kind of works. I've also done the same thing on the other side. So if we take a look here, this is how it looked before. This is how it looks after. A few little strands that I haven't filled in, but there's some other stuff that's going on here as well. Let's take a brief look here. So this was a little bit trickier because there's a lot of hair to deal with at some point. And in fact, if we look at, let's look at this next frame here. Yeah, if we look at this one here, there's actually more hair we want to add in than we need to sort of remove. So there's only like a tiny bit of the wire we need to remove. That's going to be the next part we tackle, because we're going to use a different technique to deal with this rather than deal with hundreds and hundreds of strands. Over and above that, let's go over to another one. I'll close up some of these here. There we go. Come back to that. On the shoulder, look at that. I've just done a similar thing by adding hair back in there onto the shoulder as well. And we've done that in exactly the same way as the previous part. So I've just added in my hair strands and just floated those over the top. There we go. Cool, so now we are all caught up on where we are. Bring this back over here. Let's come and take a quick look at the right-hand side again. So we're going from about frame 54-ish. That'll take us back down to maybe frame 50, because we're going to see how we can start to use frame-by-frame painting to help us with this. This is our roto node of the hair. I'll turn off the layers that are not interesting to me. And we're left with these ones. And if we take a look, around about frame, oh golly, where is it? It's like fairly close in. About frame 91, maybe even before that. I don't know, 93 maybe. 93 is probably the last frame where there's any kind of interesting wire being shown. So there's no point me going in and rotoing in tons and tons of different hair strands there because we're not going to see them. It's just going to be a complete wasted effort. So around about 94, I'm going to create one more shape. And I've got a hair layer, just like we did previously. I'm just going to use this to kind of come in and go, thank you very much. Bring that in there. This is going to be my hair just taking over everything else. So let's turn this on and off. I'll call this one big hair stop frame 91. So I know what's going on here. And do the thing I did before, set a keyframe with my opacity here to on, set a keyframe with my opacity off on the frame before, frame 93. Got all my frames out there. So frame 93, it's off. Frame 94, it's completely on. And then it's just a case of, I don't really need to do all that much with it actually. Let's just bring this in here. I think that should be, yeah, I mean, that's going to be plenty, isn't it? So this is going to overtake the rest of the thing there. And oh, I'm glad I did this view. So it means I can just tighten this up a little bit. So hold down the Alt key to make that into a corner. That's just a big blocking shape. So now I don't have to worry about any of that. So if we look at it in the composite now, cool, we'll just play that forwards. Just got a few areas where we do need to see, hang on, let's go between, I'm using my one and two buttons to move between output and foreground. So there's a few frames where we need to tighten up some of that, but I can't, you know, I don't really want to be making lots of small shapes for this, just to fill in that last little bit. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to use paint. And I'm going to use paint to do frame by frame work on the alpha channel only. So remember, we've got the alpha channel coming out from the roto. So that's the alpha channel we've got coming out from the roto, feeding in to the composite node. So if we put in a paint node in between the roto and the composite, we can just paint in the alpha and make that look nice. And we could do that faster than we could do with adding in tons and tons of roto. So it's this sort of blended approach that makes things really interesting. But now we've got something that can't go in the group. We've grouped all these things together. Is that a problem? No, not really. I can right click on my group, ungroup everything, put my paint back in there. Thank you very much. And then when we finish this, I can group everything back together again. And I will call this one, call this paint first, so we know what it is. Paint, hair, alpha, bottom, right. Then we'll fill in the frames. It's probably going to be like frames 50 to, what was say, 93, wasn't it? Now, paint's an interesting one. Another way of handling paint actually would be to connect the objects together, so yellow to yellow. And then on the input of the paint, I can go straight to the original. This means I can see the shapes and only paint within those shapes, but it's not going to feed the alpha that I've already created through the roto. So I'm going to just come straight from the roto into here. I mean, we could have the shapes on just for reference, I suppose. We're probably more interested in this overlay here. I'm going to come up to my overlay color. And I'm going to set this a little bit higher, actually quite a lot higher than we had it before. I'm going to set this to 60 so that I can see what I need to paint out and what I need to keep in. Now, the final thing before I start doing any paint work is I want to stabilize out my viewer. And the nice thing about silhouette is that if I come up to stabilize up at the top, I can stabilize out the viewer across any of my nodes and any of the layers within my node. So probably the best one, I think if I've got like a big hair one, maybe even the back roto from the wires, that might be good enough because that might just, yeah, that's good. That's just canceling out the movement of the body. That's actually pretty good. I don't mind that at all. So now what there is left for us to do is to come in and start painting in missing areas. So I'm going to paint in a solid color. So got my white and I'm only going to paint alpha only. So we just need to paint the alpha only. And let's see what happens if I paint the alpha. Bloop, like that. It's going to pass that through. It's going to bring that stroke in there. So if only there was a way of being able to see what was going on in the composite and in the paint simultaneously, so we could see what was actually happening. Well, there is. I'm just going to clear this paint stroke. Just let's delete all of my paint there. There we go. And let's set our viewers up so that we can work properly with this type of job. So I'm going to come up to the top left, and there's a little plus next to my viewer. And if I press on that plus, it gives me another node viewer. This was a feature that was introduced in Silhouette 2020, I believe. And I can just dock that wherever I need to. Let's just bring that over. I can now select any of the nodes that I was working on. And I believe I'm looking for Composite 3. So I can have this completely independent. So I can look at what's going on here. I can look at what's going on here as well. If I want to, I can link these viewers together. If we come into Preferences, I come into Viewer, I can go Synchronize Viewer, hit Apply on that. And now when I pan around here, it's going to pan around in both views. Also means when I zoom in and zoom out on one viewer, they're going to zoom simultaneously as well. Now my workspace isn't set up for this because I've still got my trees on the right hand side. I'm in the streamlined workspace, but if you're in a roto workspace, this is a great view to have. I'm going to turn off my synchronized viewers. Hit apply and hit OK because I want these independent. I just want to be looking at these. Now, if I use Z and X to move between frames, you can see they still move between views. They still synchronize in that sort of way, but I've got a bit more kind of independence between them. This exercise sets the stage for part 12, where we begin to do the paintwork. And it's important to emphasize that the less we leave for frame by frame paint, the faster it's going to be for a consistent result. So now we've done all the prep work, let's hop to exercise 12 now and get the actual paint done.